We can talk now to the Labour MP, Stephen Kinnock, from the Commons Select Committee on Exiting the EU. Stephen, hello, welcome to the programme.
Hello, good evening.
So have you seen the redacted version?
Yes, I have. Right. And it's not really right to say it's redacted, it's edited. So it's not as if we've got a bunch of documents with black lines going through it. We've just got documents. And what is absolutely clear is if you look at the resolution that was passed unanimously by the House on the 1st of November, that specifically asks for the impact assessments, they're not there. So if we're using the unanimous resolution of the House of the 1st of November as a benchmark, then the government is clearly in breach of that resolution.
How much has been left out as far as you're aware?
As I look at it, I don't see anything which is an assessment of what the different types of Brexit would mean for different parts of our economy. So there's extensive information on the different sectors in our economy and on the regulatory regime for each in terms of what the EU regulates and how that works. But there's no assessment of what different kinds of Brexit would have in terms of impact on those sectors, which is absolutely clearly what the whole point of this exercise was.
Yeah, but what assurances have you got that assessment has been done in a comprehensive fashion?
I have no idea, because all we know is that on the 1st of November, the House unanimously voted to instruct the government to give us these impact assessments. We were told they exist. But if that's the benchmark for the documents that were laid before the committee today, then the government is falling seriously short. In my view, David Davis is sailing very close indeed to being in contempt of Parliament.
Yeah, I mean, I suspect you know what I've heard, which is that one argument here is that actually there's a level of unpreparedness amongst the Department for Exiting the EU, and that the document was thin to begin with, and there actually is no impact assessment.
Yeah, I think it's one of those where either these exist and they're being withheld, which is then a breach of this resolution and probably contempt of Parliament, or they don't exist at all, which would be a damning indictment of the total lack of preparedness of the government for something which could potentially cost thousands and thousands of jobs and millions of pounds in terms of growth and our GDP and the livelihoods of our communities up and down the country. So either way, I think the government is in seriously hot water on this
one. But I mean, people listening in will think, there they go again. Here's the Labour Party trying to make political capital out of the Brexit negotiations. And if I could just further that by saying David Davis has said there is no guarantee that the 21 MPs on the Commons Select Committee can keep information secret. So he must be concerned as well that the temptation to make political capital out of all of this will mean that some of the information, if it was in there, could be compromised.
2 points on that. I think the critical point is that on the 1st of November, the House voted unanimously to instruct the government. The government decided not to whip its members of Parliament to vote against the opposition motion, and therefore it passed. And if we're going to take the House of Commons seriously at all, then we have to recognise that this is a binding motion, and that is also what the Speaker has confirmed on several occasions. This is binding on ministers. The other point I'd make is that we had a deal, or we thought we had a deal, between Hilary Benn, the chair of the Brexit Committee, and David Davis, that they would provide us with the full document, with recommendations as to what should not be in there, and we would have a dialogue with them and come to a joint agreement as grown-ups. And instead, they've decided to treat us as children, and by definition, they're also, I think, treating the British people as children.
Well, you say it's not an impact assessment. What is in there?
It is a lengthy analysis of the current state of the sector, from everything from agriculture to the steel industry to the automotive sector. And then it is a description of the regulatory regime. So what EU legislation is in place in terms of compliance, product standards, rules of origin, all of that. And then there are some comments from industry and stakeholders in terms of what they'd like to see from this process. So it's descriptive. It's just a description of the situation. It's the sector analysis bit, but it's not the impact assessment. There is no judgment in there of the government of what the impact could be.
So there are no figures at all about the implication of WTO rules on any of those financial sectors?
None whatsoever. It's a description of the current state of the sector. It is not a scenario of, you know, what would a WTO Brexit mean? What would an EEA Brexit mean? What would crashing out?
So you're going to force David Davis to unredact?
Well, we have summoned him to come to the committee. He needs to come and explain himself. And he can't really unredact if these impact assessments don't exist.
No.
So we need to get to the bottom of, do they exist or do they not?
Okay.
But I think, as I say, I think the government is in seriously hot water on this. And David Davis is sailing very close to being in contempt of Parliament.
Stephen Kinnock, thank you very much indeed. 5:57.